actually lost a lot of friends because they didn't understand how much I loved wrestling.
Right.
I was, you know, going to shows and I was the only girl who was, you know, sitting in the, you know, high school gym, watching whatever matches it was.
Yeah.
And I, you know, was just consuming everything. Like, I just loved it.
And because then of that.
It was about 6 months into watching it that Kevin was like, well, why don't you do our show?
Right.
And I didn't feel like I was knowledgeable enough at the time.
And but you did it.
I did do it.
Yeah.
And then, very nervously.
We're rolling? Are we recording? Is it going now? Rolling. Okay. Hey, everybody. What's up? It is One-on-One with me, Kristian Harloff. Thank you so much for joining us. Today, I get to interview my friend Cathy Kelley. Now, I've known Cathy Kelley for a long time now, about 6 years. She was the first guest on the Schmoes No Movie Show back in the day when she was merely an after-show host on the Afterbuzz network. And that's where I met her. And now she has blown up. She is doing a lot of stuff for WWE. She does a lot of their online stuff, their digital stuff. She has really gathered a huge following. And it was a lot of fun to talk to her. We covered the WWE stuff for sure, but we really talked about her, about where she grew up, being the daughter of a single mom, being an awkward kid, how she was picked on as a kid, how she was able to kind of struggle past that. It was a lot. We went deep. It was a good interview. I love Cathy. You'll love Cathy. And I hope you enjoy it. Make sure that you go to the audio version if you haven't done that. Get all of the interviews that we do on One-on-One here. It's not just this particular show. Mark Riley does his Riley Roundtable on One-on-One. You've got Perry Nemiroff who does some interviews here. Ryan Satin will do interviews, Roka will do interviews, and then all of these long-form interviews that I do, whether they are on Collider Live or this show, live on that feed. So go on over there to the Apple Podcast feed, subscribe, and we'll see you soon. Welcome back to One-on-One with me, Kristian Harloff. This is the show where I just sit down, shoot the shit with professionals, friends. I have one of both with me today, and she is a friend. She is someone I actually met through this space, through podcasting and just through mutual friends. But then, man, she blow up. She is part of the WWE. She is a host. She's an excellent baker, chef.
I appreciate that you mentioned that.
I have to do that. That's how I knew you first. I remember when you when you came on to the Schmo Show, you brought treats.
I forgot about that.
Hell yeah. Well, how I didn't.
That was like the heyday when I actually had time to bake.
Well, but you get to do it a little bit more now.
Sometimes, yeah.
Well, let me introduce you. It's Cathy Kelley. Cathy Kelley is here. For those of you, again, who didn't know her from the Schmoes days, and if you're wrestling fans, you certainly know who she is. She's a friend, and it's nice to see you again.
Yeah.
We've got to see each other twice in like a week.
I know. It's crazy. I don't get to see anyone that often.
I know. So there you go. So we have caught up a little bit. We got to sit down, have lunch, and then we decided, let's just do it on the air for a little bit.
Some poke nachos. It was
delicious, weren't they?
Wonderful.
They were really good over at the Yard House.
Best day of my life.
Props to the Yard House. Sponsored the show. I'm never mentioning it again. let's talk about you, because I want to hear. This is the fun thing about this show is that I know a lot about my friends, but I don't know nearly as much as I think I do.
Yeah. Surface stuff.
Surface stuff.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know. Like, you know, we've hung out. We've hung out outside of
for
work.
For years, too.
Yeah. But it's like but still, there's only so much you can talk to someone about. Who they are, social media posts and things of that nature. I know that you are very close with your mom.
Yeah.
From your posts and from conversations and stuff too. Where did you grow up?
So I grew up in Chicago, suburbs of Chicago. She grew up in Manhattan, but relocated there when she got a job. And she was a single mom. She raised me to be an independent person and human. I really respect. I think like I was definitely a brat when I was growing up, but now like taking a step back from that and seeing how much she did for me, I really appreciate like all of that.
I had a conversation with my mother today. Actually, I was on the way in, and it's funny because you don't, when you're 9, 10, you think you know how you're acting, but like you said, in retrospect, when you look back, you're like, oh, maybe, because you don't understand.
Even 5 years ago, even 2 years ago, I thought that I was super mature, and then looking back, I'm like, yeah, I probably could have handled that situation a little bit better.
Sure, even when you're 80, you're like, oh, man, when I was 60, boy, was I a young punk.
I probably won't remember at that point. I'll block it all out of my memory. Be happy and senile.
Well, you mentioned a single mom. Did you know your dad?
So I did know him. He was kind of out of the picture before I was born. Okay. They were together for a while, and then he actually followed her to Chicago. They bought a house. She got pregnant, and he left.
He left while she was pregnant?
Yeah.
So it got scared and just, like, took off?
I know a little bit of the situation, but I think that he... Like, I used to joke about this in high school, and I'm a little bit more open about it now, is I felt like I was kind of the midlife crisis. Like, most people get, like, a motorcycle or a, you know, new car.
Right.
He got a baby, and he wasn't really sure what to do with that because he was much older than her.
Okay. How much older?
She was 31 at the time, yeah. And he was 14 years older than her.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Which isn't much.
It's not much, but it's that's but still it's,
I mean, he also had a family before, so he had two sons. Wow. I have two half-brothers.
Met them? Have you met them?
Yeah. The younger one is 11 years older than me, and the older one is 15 years older than me.
Oh, man. Okay.
Yeah. So it's weird because while I have that side of my family, I'm not really close with them.
Yeah.
Because even though he was in the picture, it wasn't really significant.
Right.
So
did you hold like resentment and stuff too for him? Because I just had like Dan Merle on last week, which was very similar, similar story. Just, and I had kind of asked the same questions too. There's different ways that people deal with us a parent leaving, right? It's either I understand when I'm older. It's why did you do that? It's the resentment. And you can also take that into relationships.
Yeah.
So did you see a lot of that?
I definitely see all of that.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't think when I was younger I really resented it. And I don't know that I resent it now. I've come to terms with it. I definitely take it into relationships, both friendships and, you know, romantic relationships now.
Right.
But, like, I remember one of my earliest memories is actually being in a hotel with my grandma, who took care of me a lot too, and I remember being at the pool, and obviously she was older, she's my grandma,
right.
And this dad playing with his little daughter who was around my age, and he was like throwing her up in the air and into the pool, and them having so much fun, and remembering like, why is my life not like that?
Right, and that just kind of, and yes, that sticks with you. And how old were you at the time?
Probably like 4.
Yeah. That can hit you. I mean, it's funny. Just to bring back that conversation I had with my mother today. She asked me, you know, because my parents don't even speak. Like, they haven't for, 30 years.
Yeah.
They have brief conversations, if that.
Which is so tough as a kid, too, to experience
it's
that.
It's horrible. My brother just passed away this past August.
Yeah.
And they did, And to be honest, it's more my dad. He just wasn't speaking to my mom, and my mom was very open about it. Just didn't happen for whatever reason. I just can't do it. And my mom asked me today, when you know, holidays and stuff, do you ever think about having that family? Because my wife's parents are divorced,
mm-hmm.
but they still come over for holidays.
Yeah,
and that unit is still there. You know. And I said, you know, every time I watch a movie and I see these families that are together, like this big family, so I always, it's very similar to what you're talking about. You kind of crave it because I never had that.
Yeah. No, definitely. I mean, I think I look for that in like when I'm dating too. I'm like, does the person have a cool family that I can hang out with? Because I feel like it really is like my grandparents have passed away. It really is just me and my mom at this point.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of family friends that have kind of turned into family. Like, that's where we do Thanksgivings and Christmases.
Right.
She taught med school, so lot of her, like, students, they were with her because they got their MD and their PhD, so they were with her for 7 years.
Oh, man, so you're running around with brains, too, aren't you?
Well, they really are a part of our life. Yeah. But, yeah, my mom was weird. When I was growing up, like, my bedtime stories were all about DNA and like the
it's like Jurassic Park.
No, they're kids books that are actually about like the like genetics and stuff. So that's
you were
what
taught
she
that stuff. And were you pretty smart? Were you pretty smart kid? Do well in high school?
I don't know that I did well because I was so focused, especially in high school. I really really wanted to act. Like,
oh, really?
Since I was probably like as early as I can remember, actually, kindergarten, first grade, like I would just ask to be in every single school performance, wanted to do dance, wanted to do ice skating.
Okay, so those were the goals. You always wanted to perform.
Yeah. Okay. So I was never really focused on, you know, book work or reading. I had really actually struggled with reading comprehension because I couldn't focus. My mind was like in a million different places.
ADD?
I think I was never actually diagnosed. Okay. My half brothers both have it.
Okay.
So
you have the symptoms though.
Yeah.
Yeah. Me too. But when you're in, so well, your mother though, because obviously she is a brain. Is she encouraging you more on the academics, or does she encourage you once she finds out that you really want to perform and do these things? What's that relationship like at that point?
Honestly, I think she was just trying to stay afloat because. My dad leaving, that put a really big financial burden on her.
Oh, he wasn't helping financially?
No.
Oh,
okay. They had just bought a house together that was well out of her price range, but she did it because she thought that this was what it was. And so her and I, when I was born, we moved into a small apartment. Like the first few years, I remember I slept on a mattress on the floor. And she just, I mean, like, she did it all on her own because she had moved away from her family, so she didn't really have a support system around.
Right.
She was still trying to pursue her work, so she was working, you know, 80 hours a week, whether that was in the office or taking home grants to review and write at home
right.
while she was taking care of me. I was in preschool yeah. every single day of the week, and then when
well,
I had
work,
a sick
though?
Day, she would, like, bring me into work.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
How does that work, though? Because I know... Again, from having we have two daughters, and it's like the amount of attention, because your mom is so, you guys are so close too, that it just seems she's instilled a lot of the things, the toughness that you're talking about in you. Like
yeah.
You see that in you, and like work ethic and things of that nature. But so when she's doing all the work, and because you also, for someone who's in preschool, you got to give a preschool kid a lot of attention
yeah.
as well too. How is she able to balance all of that?
I don't know how she did
yeah.
it. Looking back, like
a lot of TV?
Well, I actually wasn't allowed to watch much TV.
Wow.
What I remember is, like, when I was a kid, we would sit on Sundays and watch football, and she would, like, have her grant applications, and she would just sit on the couch, and she would be reviewing them, and I would play and, you know, watch football, and that was it.
Wow, but she was pretty disciplined.
I don't know. I think, like I said, like, she was just trying to stay
yeah.
afloat. Like, I was a good kid for the most part. Like, I was really socially awkward, so I didn't have that many friends to
which
get in
is
trouble
crazy.
With.
Which is crazy to me.
So,
which is so crazy.
So,
man.
Yeah, I was, like, a really good kid.
Yeah.
I was just a brat sometimes because I really didn't understand. She never said a bad word about my dad whatsoever.
Smart.
None of my
That's
family
good.
Members did. And so I really didn't learn that side of my life until I was maybe... like 16, 17, 18 years old.
But that also allows you to, maybe I'm wrong, but not be that angry. Because I think
yeah.
that if someone is constantly putting down someone else,
yeah.
especially as a young kid, you're going to take that's just the way it is. And then that the insults start coming, the anger starts coming, and you can take that into school and stuff. And they didn't do that, which I think was pretty smart.
Yeah, and I think looking back too, like, I am so appreciative of not just my mom, but the people that did help her of... you know, she had two best friends that lived in Chicago at the time who took care of me a lot
mm-hmm.
when I was growing up. She had a really good support system. Her boss actually, when I was born, let her take me into the office every single day until I was old enough to get into preschool.
That's
so
great.
If you can imagine going into a hospital
like
environment
yeah,
when
yeah.
you're, you know, 0 to 6 months old.
Yeah, but still, I mean, that's also a testament to your mom as well, too, is that they wanted her there, they trusted her, the fact that they probably thought she was, you know, someone they wanted around to do what you have to do to make it work. That's really cool.
And then I'm at the point where I'm like, I hit traffic and my entire day melts down.
Yeah, it's also our generation.
I don't know how she dealt with any of it.
Yeah, I think this generation's a little tougher, too.
Yeah.
But, okay, so the thing that you said that I want to go back to is
yeah.
that you, awkward kid, I was a pretty awkward kid myself, too.
Really?
Oh, yeah. From
You're still an awkward kid.
I am.
No.
I am. It's true. I mean, yeah. I talk about Star Wars every Thursday.
That's not awkward. That's awesome.
But, I was. And I wasn't very confident in myself for a long time.
Yeah.
I didn't really grow into, like, the hairstyle. I was very young. I looked very young when I was in eighth grade. I looked like I was 11 or 10, you know, and all these other kids. I mentioned this kid before, this kid Jessen. He was one of those kids where he was 13, but he looked 40.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and it's just like, oh, look, he just bench pressed a horse.
But where is he now? Where's Jessen now?
Jessen's actually, he's got a family and he's doing all right with himself.
Okay.
He's still in Queens.
Okay.
He's doing good. He's a good kid. He's a good guy. He was just that guy that he had a mustache at like 6. You know, it's like, so, but anyway, it took me a while. It didn't really hit
my stride, my confidence until like 17, 18. Yeah. So, and I bring that up with you because I saw you post a picture recently from when you just went to the awards the other day.
Oh, yeah.
And then you posted a picture of yourself back in the day, I guess during that awkward phase, yeah. Right?
Honestly, that's not even the most awkward pictures. Okay. I made my mom throw out so many pictures, I think from when I was like 12 until I was 16. There's yeah. just a gap in all of the photo albums because I went through and I tore them all up.
You tore, because it was just, it was time in your life you just wanted to...
I wanted to forget it. Yeah. Like, I was, one, like, socially awkward where I didn't really have that many friends, but I went through a really bad depression stage in high school where I didn't really know how to get out of it.
How'd you get there? What happened?
I think it was a mixture of bullying in school, not really feeling like I had that many friends.
Yeah. But who was bullying you? Why were they bullying you? Like,
because I was that awkward theater kid. Like, yeah. I remember sophomore year, we were supposed to bring in a song lyrics that reminded us of poetry mm-hmm. to our English class. And everyone was bringing in, like, Blink 182 and, mm-hmm. like, all of these, like, cool bands at the time. Not saying that Blink 182 isn't cool, but I brought in On My Own from Les Mis.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah. they played it. Like, I just expected, oh, we would bring in the lyrics yeah, yeah. and that was our assignment. Not that we would have to stand in front of the entire class, explain.
Right. And here's this little cultured Cathy Kelley coming in.
Yeah, this yeah. is me coming in. And, like, I didn't bring in the song, so my teacher found a version online, mm. which is, like, very, very intense for, you know, a group of 15, 16-year-olds. Right. So I was just made fun of the rest of the class. And at the now I'm like, oh, well, that's pretty cool that was
yeah.
the song that I brought in. But at the same time, it was really hard because I felt like I just didn't fit in.
Right. And so I'm sure that one of the things that helped me is that it pushes you more towards that goal of I'm getting the hell out of here. I'm mm-hmm. going to do something else. Because what happens? So we talked about it before we went on air, though, too, relationship wise. Right.
Yeah.
Are relationships happening during high school or is that something that happens later on after you leave?
I didn't have my first kiss until the middle of senior year of high school.
High school. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, I was...
Because of self-confidence and things
like
that?
No, it wasn't. I just wasn't being asked out. I wasn't in that space. I had, like, two friends and...
People
honestly,
are watching this and listening to me. What the hell is wrong
well,
with
like,
people?
Like, okay, so one, I was really into theater, and then I was also really into obscure bands.
Right.
So I was into, like, all the emo bands. Like,
but weren't there other nerdy kids that were doing the same thing?
Like, not that I knew of.
Not in,
like,
the same circles?
There were definitely theater kids, but I was even made fun of by them.
Really?
Like, I was not the lead in any of these plays, too. Like, I was the extra. Yeah. I was the maid in Sound of Music who has two lines. Like,
so
I
were
wasn't...
Were you very quiet also?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I was very, like, to myself. I'm introverted in general, mm-hmm. but, like, in that time of my life, and I don't know what was the switch of it, but, you know, for the beginning stages, like when I was in the theater performances in grade school,
yeah.
I was every single lead in every single show. And then I think around like 12, 13, I started to get really, really self-conscious.
Okay.
And I got really, like, I was not confident on stage. Like, whenever we would do auditions, I would start to hyperventilate.
Oh, wow.
And so I wasn't able to do that anymore. I still loved it so much, and I knew that that's where I wanted to be. Like, I would imagine, like, I would watch TV or, like, watch movies and be like, that's what I want to do.
Right, doesn't it? And that really kicks your ass, too, because
yeah.
you know you have it in you, but there's something holding you back. Like,
mm-hmm.
that's happened to me so many times, and especially when I was doing stand-up, like, I would have these incredible sets. And then there was that one where everyone was there, but it was the magic that was there the night before, just for some reason,
yeah.
it wasn't coming out. And you know it's in there, and it just shuts you down. And that hurts mentally,
mm-hmm.
And especially at 16 or 17 years
yeah.
old. So that's what kind of throws you into this depression.
Yeah, I think it was a huge lack of self-confidence, feeling a little bit unwanted, and not having that many friends. Like, it was either my 15th or 16th birthday. I think my mom and my uncle and one teacher that wrote down every kid's birthday were like the only people that wished me happy birthday.
Oh, man.
And so that was like one of the lowest points of my life.
Right.
Birthdays were really important to us because, So my grandpa was actually a Holocaust survivor.
Oh, wow.
And they weren't able to celebrate religious holidays, obviously. Yeah. So our family birthdays are really important. So
when do you learn about all that stuff? When does your mom? Because I'm always so curious with my daughter who's seven, right? Like we just she learned a lot about Martin Luther King already, mm-hmm. and just things that are deep for a seven-year-old learning about the civil rights and stuff. I wanted to teach her because she should know.
History repeats itself, unfortunately.
Yes, and she's got a friend, this kid who he's I believe he's Indian descent, but he was left in like a garbage can when he was younger, this kid.
Wow.
But his mom adopted him. They're good friends. And then she said to me, my daughter's like, you know, back a long time ago, I wouldn't be able to, it would be illegal for me to hang out with him.
Yeah.
I'm like, you're right. It would be, but it's not the way it is today. And we had this whole really good conversation. Yeah. It made me feel good that she learned this stuff. But then there's also things like when it comes to like Holocaust and that.
Yeah.
Still might be the most horrendous, horrific thing that humans will or ever could do. I mean, it's just unfathomable that humans could do that type mm-hmm. of thing. But at what point, A, do you find out about your grandfather? And when your mom sits you down and tells you about this, is it very young about what happened?
He was the one that told me about it. He was very open about it. We actually went... So he was never in a concentration camp, but pretty much everyone in his family was. His mom at the time had the foresight to send him on this train called the Kindertransport mm-hmm. out of Austria. And so he was basically put up as a foster kid in England, in Coventry, England. Went to a really nice prep school there, so he really had no idea what was going on.
Right.
But at the time, or what he found out years later was, I think it was... 5% of the kids that were sent on the train ever saw their families again. Wow. And his mother, who was actually a really successful businesswoman, lost everything.
Wow.
But she was able to escape. And once she met up with him a few years later, they moved over to the United States. So he was very open about it. We actually went back to visit Coventry, England. Mm-hmm. When I was like 1 year old, we went to Germany and saw like the Berlin Wall.
Family history, and it just kind of just
I knew all of that, and that's why I say that I was a brat when I was younger, because I didn't really like I was just so used to it. Like I heard those stories, and now, you know, when you hear about the kid that was adopted that you just mentioned, yeah. and you know, hearing my grandpa's story or remembering that, I do really feel grateful for like having a mom who loved me, and like I haven't had to experience a lot of that pain and heartbreak.
Right, and that's why. And we interweave from this birthday, and that's why birthdays are so important. But it did stick with you, obviously, because of that.
That sounds so stupid. Birthdays are so important.
It's not stupid.
They shouldn't be after you're like 6 years old.
I don't necessarily know. I don't think that's true. I think that there's one thing that I always laugh about with my brother that we always talk about is that. Birthdays, though, it's your mother that should be celebrated, not you. What did you do? You know, you're just like, she's the one.
She birthed a 9-pound, 9-ounce baby.
That's what I'm saying. Like, so I saw my wife went through it twice, and I'm like, you kids don't get to celebrate anything. I don't care what you want. But anyway. All right, so let's talk about this kid, though, that winds up finally senior year, gets the balls to ask you out.
I don't know that it was that. It was I dated a kid from camp. I went to summer camp 1 year.
You had to go outside of the out of the factory.
I mean, like, that was part of it too. Yeah. Is I even remember in that phase of my life, like in high school, begging my mom to transfer schools, like begging her, because I was so like I could not get out of it. I could not escape. And I just wanted to be a different person. I had told her since I was like 10 years old that I wanted to move out to LA.
Oh, wow. So you knew that early. Okay.
Yeah. We came out for Thanksgivings every single year because we had the family friends out here.
Yeah.
And I begged her to transfer me to a different high school because I just felt like I couldn't be who I wanted to be there.
And it was harder for her because of work and everything, right?
That's what she can. I think, yeah, like I said, she was just trying to stay afloat. Yeah. Like she was working so much of, she would leave for work right when I got up in the morning and was home, you know, hours after I got home from school. So.
Well, so what's the journey then? So you get from, so this kid at camp is just a kiss and that's all it is. He's not a boyfriend or anything.
No, he was like my boyfriend for 2 months. It was months. You know, high school relationship.
But that also, the reason why that's so relevant is because from someone who was awkward, who had never kissed a boy before that, that does change confidence in general. It doesn't matter who you are, because it's the first time it ever happens. And inside it's like, okay, this is the first actual kiss itself must have been like, oh my God, here it is, alarms going off, it's craziness. And it's, I remember the first time I had kissed a girl in a movie theater, and it was the most awkward, it's the most awkward thing in the world. But it was still, I remember the, here it is, first time. I want to do this more.
Yeah.
You know, that's kind of, but that's, guys and girls are different as well, yeah, too. But.
I think I definitely, like, I romanticize relationships a lot. Mm. And
still?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely still. Like, in general, like, not just romantic ones, but, like, friendships. Like, I want to see the best in everyone. And yeah. So sometimes I give people more chances or opportunities than I think that they deserve. But yeah, like going back to that relationship, that I don't know that one was super significant, but there was one right after that stuck with me a lot because it was a really bad relationship.
Bad how?
So
arguments?
No, not arguments. Right. I've really only fought in a couple relationships. I feel like I'm very good at expressing what I need to express in a calm, like direct manner.
Yeah.
So it doesn't cause fights. But that one, took a worse toll on my confidence because he was one of the kids that had made fun of me when I was younger.
Oh.
And for whatever reason, I felt like I needed to date him in high school and actually developed an eating disorder because of that. Because
of him.
Yeah, like him and his friends, like when they, this sounds so bad, when they would bully me, like they would write things like no fat chicks on their arm, and they would show me. Like when we're in the library.
Wow. Why would you date that guy? Just because had more confidence? Were you starting to come more into your own? Or, and then you were like, you know what? That was the guy that made fun of me, but now I'm going to, I don't know.
Now I channel it into positive things of a prove people wrong kind of attitude.
Right.
But at the time, I think I was just so lost and I like wanted to be, you know, this different person. Mm-hmm. And that was, you know, the like quintessential teen movie, like popular kid in high school.
Right.
That I just wanted to be accepted and I wanted to like go to the parties and have a lot of friends.
Right. And he approached you afterwards? Had you start to blossom a little bit more? Is that why? And then he approached you and said, oh, she's.
I guess so. Yeah. I mean, like I was definitely more of myself.
Right.
In that, like, I was going to concerts every single weekend, like with my one friend. And I felt like I did blossom a little bit, but like, honestly, dating him was a really bad decision for me. And yeah. I think, honestly, part of it is probably because I didn't have that father influence telling me, like, oh, no, you should be dating someone that is not just respectful of you, but of other people. And
right. You had no reference.
Yeah, exactly. That was a really, really bad time in my life.
So how long did you date this guy for?
Again, it was only a few months,
but still, I mean, that's, you know, 2 months and that's could be damaging for that long. It's a lot. That's a lot. So, and he's making still jokes on you. He's putting you down.
I mean, like there were things that he said to me that looking back, like, I don't know why, I dated him, but like he would say, oh, well, my mom had to stay in shape. Otherwise my dad would cheat on her.
He definitely had a lot of issues.
And I think that he projected a lot of that onto me.
Right.
But yeah, it was, I remember after we broke up, I like spiraled into this. Yeah. Like I thought I was getting better, as far as the eating disorder went, but, we went on this like school retreat and my mom actually had to pick me up early 'cause I got really sick. And she had to take me to the hospital and they weighed me and I was 97 pounds.
Wow. At what, 18 years old?
17 years old.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And so for like my height, like 5'6", 5'7", like
that's really low.
Yeah.
And then how do you get out of that? How do you pull your, how did your mom helps you?
Honestly, she had no idea.
Oh, wow.
I was hiding it.
But even though she sees the weight loss?
She never saw. I didn't let the doctor show her. Like, I had to obviously have, like, an IV fluid.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I hit it. And she was so busy. I think that that actually hurts her a lot now because she didn't realize
it. Yeah.
I had family friends who I would see, and they would, you know, be concerned about me, or, you know, the couple friends. There was one guy friend that I had later on in senior year of high school, and he made a comment of like, oh, did you eat today? And I got really, really offended.
Yeah.
But yeah, it was obviously like a lot of just, I realize now actually from, I'm really interested in psychology. And mm-hmm. so reading a lot of like books on that is because like a lot of kids that have a parent leave, they feel this need to project that everything is perfect.
Yeah.
And so that was something that I could be in control over, was my looks.
Right.
And so I wanted to look a certain way, and I would see, you know, like the girls in the magazines that mm-hmm. looked a certain way, and I felt like I had to be that, or I was never going to be loved. Like, I was going to be unlovable.
Right. And that's, I mean, again, that's really, it stems from your childhood
mm-hmm.
and on all that. And doesn't help that, you know, you got this putz who's saying this stuff to you, and again, who knows what the hell the guy was going through, but still, it's you don't treat anybody like that.
Yeah.
And it happens. But then you're 18, then you graduate, or you 18 when you graduate?
17. Yeah.
You're the same as me. You're a Libra, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So then you leave. Do you go to LA immediately when you graduate high school, or where do you go?
I wanted to.
Right.
My mom, she of course, like, she didn't understand the whole wanting to get into acting or hosting. And even my senior year of high school, we actually put together a feature film.
Did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I had a really talented teacher who oversaw all of our film production at our high school, which is crazy to think. Like, I was editing on Avid and iMovie and, you know, all these things when I was 15, 16 years old.
Yeah.
But at the time when it wasn't as prominent.
That's true. Yeah. But you did all that. But are you healthy by the time you graduate? Or you still having issues?
No. Okay. Actually, what got me out of it was being on that film set.
Oh, being on the film set.
Yeah. Okay. So we filmed the...
Craft Services got to get you out of
exactly.
that.
Exactly. No, that's what it was. Yeah. And I was really mad at my mom because my friend who wrote the film wanted me to be the lead in it. And she said no because there was partial nudity in it.
Oh, really?
I was 17 years old. She had to sign off regardless. And it wasn't even like there was no nudity. It was just like implied, like back of your shoulder.
But she was like, no.
Because we're all like, you know, 16, 17 right. years old trying to put on this like production that we think is, I don't know.
The next Scorsese film.
Exactly.
Right. But you get out of it. You get yourself healthy on the film. So that also has got to... That mentally, that has to do a lot as well too, and that probably emotionally really ties you into this business because it's another way that kind of saves you.
And it was the first time in my life where I felt like I had friends that really genuinely understood me. Is everyone wanted to go to film school? Everyone wanted to, you know, either at NYU or USC
right.
or UCLA.
So you're in paradise.
Yeah. No, I was so happy at that point. Like, I felt like I really fit in, and then I ended up going to college.
Where'd you go?
I started at St. Louis University. Mm-hmm. They didn't have a journalism school, so that was part of the reason I transferred after my sophomore year. Started at St. Louis University, and I felt like I was exactly who I wanted to be there.
Wow.
Like, because
so you found yourself.
There were very few people. Like, I think only two people from my high school went.
Okay.
And so I felt like I could be whoever I wanted to be, and that was the most comfortable I ever felt.
And you did it
at that point in my life.
Right. And
yeah.
So where do you finish the college?
Loyola in Chicago.
Oh, you did. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. In Chicago.
They actually had just when I transferred built this gorgeous newsroom, like overlooking Michigan Avenue.
Oh, wow.
A multi-million-dollar studio. And we were the first class that got to use it.
And you enjoyed college?
I hated it.
You hated college?
Yeah.
Also?
Oh,
really?
Man, I hated it.
Why?
Oh, socially, I loved it.
Okay.
Because I felt like I really did get to mature.
Okay.
But
and met new friends.
Yeah, but I if it was my choice, I would have moved to LA when I was done with school. Okay. I would have moved to LA when I was 10. But
yeah, and your mom wanted to keep you close.
Yeah, and I felt like even so, St. Louis University, my school advisor told me that the school didn't think that journalism was a respectable career path.
Wow.
So they.
They said they used those words?
Yeah, they didn't offer multiple classes.
Wow.
There were like two classes, and I completed them both by the end of freshman year.
Right, that was it.
And then Loyola, they had a very new TV news program. Mm-hmm. And I just remember teaching everyone in the class how to edit footage because our teacher didn't know how. So I was like, what am I doing here that is helping me get to a point that I want to be? Like, I genuinely feel like I learned more in a week of interning than I did.
That's usually how it goes.
4 years of being in college.
That's absolutely how it goes. Yeah. I same thing with me. When I all the stuff that I do now, I learned more on just experience on sets or working interning at a production company and all those things.
Yeah, too. I mean, I do wish that I had focused more on the when I was at St. Louis, I did a fine arts minor, so I got to do a lot of like just drawing and painting and whatever. And then when I was at Loyola, I transferred to be a political science minor.
Oh wow!
So I wish that I had focused more on those things so that I would have spent that time learning something else. But
yeah, I mean, we got it's relationships. And I think it sounds like it was a lot of the confidence building for you. You go look from Cathy Kelley from 14, 15 into that film set, and now college. Take away the fact that you're teaching the classes when you're not supposed to, but it's meeting the people.
Needed that time to mature.
Yeah, the college was really. It seemed like it was really the classes you were taking were socially more than anything else too. Now, what I want to ask you, because unfortunately, I could talk to you for like 3 hours, but unfortunately, we both don't have enough time. Yes, time constraints. So what I do want to do is I'm going to jump ahead in time. We're going to get into DeLorean, and we're going to go.
Perfect.
We're going to go to Afterbuzz.
Okay.
And because that's how I met you.
Yeah.
I met you through Kevin Undergaro and Maria Menounos. How, because that ultimately leads to your job at WWE.
Mm-hmm.
How do you get to meet those two?
So part of that was right after college, I worked at the local ABC affiliate in Des Moines, Iowa for about 14 months. Hated Iowa, like knew that that was just not my place, made great friends there.
Right. You were meant
great
for
working
LA.
Relationships. Really yeah. And so I had a lot of people at the time that were also telling me to focus on hard news because they understood that they didn't understand the entertainment side. Mm-hmm. And so I quit my job. I sent out a bunch of emails as I was driving from Des Moines, Iowa to Los Angeles saying, hey, I'm a TV host. I'm going to move there. Edited a reel, sent it out. AfterBuzz was one of the, 10, 15 places that I sent my reel to. I had a couple auditions when I got in, which I'm realizing now is kind of unheard of when you're a new host moving to Los Angeles to have things already set up. One of the places was AfterBuzz, and I think it was like really at the inception of that network. Like there weren't that many hosts there at
the
time.
What was it, 2012 or something, 2011?
Around that time.
Yeah, because that's when I met them in like 2013.
Yeah, so they, at the time, like they had a couple people, Phil Svitek and a couple people working behind the scenes. So if a host missed a show, they would have one of their producers fill in because the show had to go on.
Right.
And they really didn't have that many hosts at the time. They're very, very new network. Now they have people just like begging to be on the
show. Yeah.
But the first show that I did was The Bachelor After Show because someone didn't make it. And Chrisley Kennedy and I actually both showed up that day because they called two people not knowing. And so there were too many hosts, and so they were like, well, one of you has to go, but we ended up staying both of us.
Well, that's great. And so that's and you get, because you did so much there, because when I was, so for those of you who don't know, when we did the Schmoes, after we transitioned from Toad Hop, Kevin and Maria were gracious enough to have us in the studio and the Schmoes ran on our channel but through their studio and we started kind of began doing the live thing, and then after I started doing the live thing, it was great. But I remember you and I went
out.
Crazy.
I remember the Toad Hop Network.
That's
remember
where,
coming in.
That's where you first came in. Yeah. That's how you. That's because Ken I think Ken had done a show with you at AfterBuzz from WWE stuff. And then Ken's like, we should have on this girl, Cathy Kelley, who knows her stuff, and she's a lot of fun, and it would be cool to...
There was some wrestling promotion, too, that he used to manage.
Tex Tunney.
I was, involved in a segment there.
Oh, were you? Okay, So he brought you in, and then... You were doing a lot. You're producing over there. Mm-hmm. You became pretty close with those guys.
That was really out of I love working, and I think that that's part of just seeing my mom constantly working.
Yeah.
And we're doing cool things. So why would I not want to work 80, 100 hours a week when you're doing it with people that you love?
And, plus experience.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I was hosting several shows over there, and then I had asked Kevin, who was working on his movie at the time,
Hal Rudnick is in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What I could be doing extra. And so part of that was, why don't we bring you in to book talent for the network? So I really actually built up a huge list of publicists that I was working with and actors and hosts and people, and bringing them in, and not just booking them for the shows that I was working on, but the other shows as well.
Yeah.
Which I think helped me when I was
I can imagine your connections
doing red
that
carpets.
Yeah. Sure.
And I started my own long form interview show with up and coming celebrities. We had a lot of people on there that I think now looking back, like Ali Raisman was a guest, and I got an hour long with her interview. And so that was really, I feel like that was the college that I needed.
Right. Yeah. I mean, and that's what we were just talking about, right? That you learn more there when you were there from what you're doing now than you did at Loyola.
Yeah.
You know, so, but the wrestling, let's go into wrestling here too, because you were doing after shows for wrestling for a bit at AfterBuzz. Where does the love from wrestling come from? Was that one of the things to where they said, hey, we have an after show, we'd love for you to watch some of this stuff and see if you like it, or you liked wrestling from the get?
No one told me to do it. It was when I was there on a full-time basis, every Tuesday morning we would watch, or every morning we would watch the shows from the night before, just in case one of us needed to fill in on a show, because
like Raw and SmackDown.
Every Tuesday morning we would watch Monday Night Raw from the night before. And the first week I just kind of did my work. The second week, was watching over my laptop. And the third week I was like, when are we watching Raw?
You're starting to get hooked.
And I fell in love with it, like to the point where, because I wasn't allowed to watch TV when I was growing up that much, so I was given half an hour, I think, a day, and that was used within minutes of my mom getting home. So.
And it wasn't wrestling.
It was probably Nickelodeon, whatever. So I had no idea what it was, and went from not knowing anything about it to that was like my entire life for a few years. I actually lost a lot of friends because they didn't understand how much I loved wrestling.
Right.
I was, going to shows, and I was the only girl who was, sitting in the, high school gym, watching whatever matches it was.
Yeah.
And I, was just consuming everything. Like, I just loved it.
And because then of that.
It was about 6 months into watching it that Kevin was like, why don't you do our show?
Right.
And I didn't feel like I was knowledgeable enough at the time.
But you did it.
I did do it.
Yeah. And then,
very nervously.
But because of that. Look, so I'll give the example, like Roxy Stryer, right?
Yeah.
So Roxy, who we both know and love, so she, when I was putting together a lot of those shows with Kevin, the initial ones that eventually became the Popcorn Talk Network, DC Movie News and Marvel Movie News were two shows that I wanted to do. The DC, the team I was going to put together, I always knew I wanted Adam Gertler on there, but I didn't know who I wanted to pair him with. So I said to Roxy, similar, I was like, I want you to do it. I think the camera, she's like, I don't know enough about DC. I was like, yeah, but you'll do the research, and you will be more prepared than anybody on that panel. And she is the most prepared person that
but
I know.
But you have to have that passion, too. Yeah. And I feel like that was something that, she might not have known that much about, but it's because she was so passionate about it that showed through.
She's still on it to this day.
Exactly.
And she knows. And now when you talk about DC, like on Clara Live, she shuts the room down because she just knows, and she'll school you on it. And I love that. And it seems like that's the same thing that happened to you when it came to wrestling, because as you're talking about it every week, you're learning more about it. and you're getting passionate about
it. Well, there was just so much history, and I didn't want to be disrespectful of, you know, there were people even on that show that had been watching literally since they were born, devoted their entire lives to it. So I didn't want to be that, you know, dumb girl that was coming on just to, you know, say that she liked something that
I like chair shots.
Yeah.
Right. That wasn't, but you weren't. You were doing way more than that. You were becoming more knowledgeable. And it ultimately leads to the fact that now you work for the company. Now, Maria Menounos had done a bunch of things, WrestleMania. She is very involved with WWE.
And she just came to WWE Evolution.
Yeah, right, right. Yeah. So she came. So there's a lot of things. She's involved with the company. And because of that and that connection, is that ultimately how you start to get opportunities to?
No, it was actually Ryan Katz. I don't know if you
knew him. Ryan. Yeah.
So Ryan, also friends with Ken, he had just started working for the company. They had just opened the Performance Center down in Orlando, Florida. So he went to work there. And he had actually asked me maybe like 6 months prior if I wanted to take part in, they didn't call it a diva search, but it was when they actually hired Eva Marie, Lana, JoJo, a bunch of those girls. And I said no. I was way too nervous for it. I didn't feel like I was pretty enough. I didn't feel like I was confident enough. So I told him no, like, don't submit me for that.
Would you not want to do ring stuff also in ring?
But there were a couple girls that got hired that were just, there was one that was a backstage interviewer, there was one that was a manager at the time. So it wasn't specifically for in-ring work.
You just didn't want, you were too
nervous. And I'm also not athletic in the slightest. So I knew that that was not going to be my forte.
Right.
But yeah, so I had said no to that. And then a few months later, I had told him, I was like, I regret that. Like, I really would love to, you know, potentially do like the panels for NXT or NXT wasn't even really that big at the time, but I wanted to do backstage interviewing. And so I'd asked him if he could submit my stuff to Michael Cole. I ended up having an audition. And around that time is when Maria and Kevin vouched for me, and they gave me a seal of approval.
I see. Okay.
And yeah, so I went in, and at the time they were not hiring anyone. So I waited after that. Like, they told me, you have a job here.
Oh, wow.
But I waited about 2 years to actually start.
2 years?
Yeah. So said, you have a job. In this very weird limbo of, like, we love you. Like, we want to use you.
We just don't have anything yet.
Yeah. Wow. So that was really, really hard.
Yeah, I'm sure. Because you're sitting around knowing that you have this gig. And you're still doing stuff at Afterbuzz at the time?
I was still doing stuff with Afterbuzz. Right. And I was apprehensive to, like, book anything else or, like, go out for other things. Because this is what I needed.
Yeah,
like really, it wasn't even that I wanted it at that point. Like, I knew I needed to be there.
But you get the call eventually 2 years later.
Yeah.
What's that call like? Who makes it? What happens?
It was more of me just following up consistently. I'm like, hey, you know, is this going to happen?
Yeah.
And one of the live event producers who isn't there anymore was really the guy that I spoke to a lot, and he's incredible. But he was like, I'll follow up. And then finally, they were looking to build out their digital platforms.
Yeah.
And I look back and I'm like, it was so fortuitous that that's when it happened, because, you know, I don't know that being in a ring in front of, you know, 10,000 people and ring announcing is what I would have been good at. But, like, I know digital. Not just hosting digital, but I know producing digital. I know which shows are going to do well and which shows aren't. And
It was the perfect gift.
Yeah. Like, looking back, everything happened at the right time for the right reasons. So
you do it. They say, this is what we want you to do. And so when I started working there, it was the same thing. We want you to, you got to move to Stanford. Is that what you had to do? You have to move to Stanford.
In case there's any breaking news.
All that stuff. Yeah. And you got to move there now. You got a place. You set yourself up.
I had a place. Yeah.
You got to be nervous going into a place you don't know.
Oh, so nervous.
Yeah.
One, like, socially awkward kid. Now thrust into a place of, like, people that I really respected at this point.
And it is a click there. You really have to maneuver into that thing. It's not easy.
It was also really hard because I was the first person that they ever had in digital. So they didn't have, like, I didn't have the normal, oh, you're, now what they do is they bring people in and normally they go through the performance center, which is kind of like a college in itself of, you know, everyone's learning how to become a superstar. So, you know, you get to meet everyone. Right. And if you're new, everyone introduces themselves to you or you introduce yourself to everyone. I was thrust in of, for about a month, I was just sitting at a table waiting for them to do the Raw pre-shows, but I wasn't allowed to like leave that room or anyone know that I was working for WWE yet because they wanted to announce it. So I was sitting with like Booker T and Corey Graves and Scott Stanford in a room for like, I think it was actually 2 months with no social interaction with anyone else. Except for my friend Sam Roberts.
Booker's cool as hell.
I love Booker. He's cool like my... Yeah, crazy uncle. I love him.
I can't say anything to Corey. I don't know Corey, but like Booker's just from the first interaction I ever had with him when I was working there.
Yeah,
and then now from working with him in Schmodown, I love
awesome.
That.
Yeah.
Oh, I love that too.
But yeah, so I went from that like hosting every single day to not doing anything on camera for 2 months. I felt like I was a bird in a cage.
Right.
Like I wasn't allowed to. I felt like I lost my ability to host.
Right.
Well, and then
when's that change?
Well, literally. So that was the 2 months where I wasn't allowed to tell anyone that I worked there, and then WrestleMania.
So which WrestleMania?
It was WrestleMania 30.
Who was the main event? Do you remember?
Oh, God. I
can't remember.
It was trying to think probably it was. Roman Brock.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So then that, so that 30, happens.
31, 32.
Okay.
I'm trying to think.
When Roman
3 years
won.
Ago.
Roman
yeah.
won.
So... Yeah. Yeah, I just remember, like, not feeling the most confident. Like, meeting people was really hard, too, because there was really no one who was introducing me or...
Oh, yeah.
Like, I was also told at the time, if you go in as a fan, you will be fired.
Yeah.
And I was so nervous. Like, I didn't want to even... Like, I knew, okay, you have to go up and you have to shake everyone's hand. I was too nervous to do that.
Yeah.
Which I think actually like didn't bode well for me.
Yeah, well, it's the same thing with me. Like when at the time when I first started there, I went in. It was funny because I should have worked there when I wasn't a fan, which was after I was working there. Because when I got there, it was watching these people that you knew and like Stone Cold I saw in the alley. I was like, well, I in the lobby of this hotel, and I was like, I gotta go up to him and I gotta tell him I'm gonna be writing for this guy.
Yeah,
I gotta go and, you know, and I went up and I definitely told him I was a new writer, it was great, but I could tell that the nervousness was there and the shakiness was there. And it takes a little bit to get over it, but you obviously got over it because now you're doing so much. Because you went from, I remember seeing you on like a couple little segments here, now you're all over the place. You were the one that broke the story about Ronda Rousey getting the title shot. There were so many things that the opportunities, now you do a lot of stuff with NXT, a lot of stuff with Triple H. And I can say from personal experience there, then that means that they accepted you because you're getting these types of opportunities and you're doing more stuff to where they, again, they trust that you can tell their story.
Yeah. I mean, one thing that I'm super proud of now is we started the show called Talking Snack.
Yes,
which is
an interview
cooking show with
some
of the superstars.
Oh, I hate that we're almost done. There's so much I want to talk to.
I know.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's been such a crazy ride. And like, I feel like we've really hit our stride. And it's really only the beginning of what they're going to be accomplishing within the digital space because I feel like there's just so many opportunities there.
Yeah.
And it's snowballing and growing into this like crazy monstrosity that I don't think anyone would have expected.
There's so much cool stuff that we were talking about at lunch or about what you're doing. I still think that they should put that show on the WWE Network. I think it needs to be like a 45-minute long-form show because you're so good at the long-form.
I love long-form interviews, and I would love to do that with the WWE superstars, but I'm just so happy that it's getting done. Like, I've never been motivated by how many views something is getting or how much you're getting paid for it. Like, I just want to do things that I love, and I think that is always what translates of, you know, other people liking it.
Yeah, and I think that's great. Okay, we got about one more minute. So I mean, so much. Oh, so much. Where so many places I want to go. So, out of the people that you met, because now you're really tight with a lot of the wrestlers too. Like, yeah. I asked you during lunch, but who are some of your girls? Some of the people that you hang out with?
I mean, I feel like it's a family, so everyone. Yeah. But
there's always the cliques. There's people that, like, when you go on the road, who do you find yourself grabbing lunch with and hanging out with? Who are you close with?
I mean, my people are probably all of the digital producers, just because that's who I spend most time with, and that's also who, if we have to ride from city to city, I'm usually on the bus, or we take a car all together. So a lot of them, I mean, all of the girls too. Yeah. Like, I feel like we're really lucky to, have a lot of like great people there. Kayla Braxton is a good friend of mine, cool. Who's also an announcer. Zelina Vega is, I don't know if you knew her prior, but she was a huge like AfterBuzz person, Kevin and Maria. It's crazy to like,
Did you guys know each other before?
Yeah, we talked about it all the time. We would go on hikes in LA and like be crying while we're walking because we just wanted to be in WWE so badly.
And there, like, you go. Then
now
you both
we're
are.
Here.
That's
and,
crazy.
Yeah, at WWE Evolution, I was interviewing her and we were both like tearing up. It was crazy.
That's really cool. By the way, I wanted to ask you before we get out of here too, because the whole scenario, we have Survivor Series. By the time this comes out, Survivor Series will already have aired. But Ronda Rousey was supposed to go against Becky.
I know.
And then Becky gets
Becky's clocked. The coolest.
She's the coolest. She's clocked in the jaw by Nia Jax.
Man.
And then she's out. She gets a concussion. The internet blows up because of it. How's she doing?
I haven't talked to her in this past week.
Oh, you haven't? Okay.
Yeah, I haven't seen her because I'm usually not on the road every single week. But I mean, I just think the world of her as a human. And I feel like this is only the beginning for her. So
talk about hitting your stride.
Yeah, even though, like, obviously, I think I and the WWE Universe wanted to see that match more than anything in the world. I don't think that this is like.
Nah, we're gonna get
not
going to
happen.
Nah, we're going to get it at WrestleMania. And I think that she's becoming the female Stone Cold Steve Austin. She is becoming like that type of, like you talk
she's
about.
She's a man.
It was really smart for them to turn her
but
heel.
How
really
cool
smart.
Is it to see someone that's just like such an awesome person succeed?
Yeah. I mean, from what I hear, everything I hear from her, whether it's you or other people that I know, they think the world of her. So if that is indeed the case, then absolutely you want to applaud people like that. But this stinks. I got to let you go.
I know.
When you're back in town, let's do this again.
Because part two.
There's so much more that I want to talk to you about this.
How was that an hour? Dang.
We're just old friends just catching up.
I know.
Pretty easy. Cathy Kelley, you find her on WWE. Also follow her at Cathy Kelley. Is that what it is?
Cathy Kelley on Instagram, Catherine Kelley. On Twitter.
Twitter, and make sure you check her out on on WWE.com.
Yes, WWE.com, WWE's YouTube page.
The whole thing.
Tell people you like talking snacks so we get a season two.
Yes, definitely do that. Congratulations on all the success. I'm very happy for you. Talking about rooting for good people, I'm rooting for you.
Thanks.
And I can't wait to have you back. Well, and we'll talk soon.
I'll bring the pokey nachos.
Please do. All right, guys. See you next week. That was it. That was the interview. I hope you enjoyed it. If you're joining us for the first time on Collider Video, hit that subscribe button, like, comment, do all that stuff. And remember, this is also on iTunes. If you're listening to iTunes right now, pull over and then rate it, subscribe it, do all that stuff. Hit pause on the treadmill for a second and let us know what you think about these shows. And we will continue to make more of them. You can find all your favorite shows from Collider on iTunes on the Collider Podcast Network. Thank you very much. See you next time.